Hello everyone, today we will discuss about thromboangiitis obliterans, TAO. So in this part mainly we will discuss about introduction, epidemiology, history, incidence and prevalence, and etiology of thromboangiitis obliterans. So myself Dr. Anandas, Assistant Professor, Department of Roganidana, Evam Vikruti Vignan, Global Institute of Ayurveda, Rajkot. So thromboangiitis obliterans, or one more name, Berger's disease, is a segmental occlusive inflammatory condition of arteries and veins characterized by thrombosis and recanalization of the affected vessels. So thromboangiitis obliterans will be known for one more name, Berger's disease. Especially this condition will be affecting the arteries and veins, the particular occlusive inflammatory condition of arteries and veins. Segment wise, it will be affecting the arteries and veins, especially portions of arteries and veins. And along with that conditions, formation of thrombosis and recanalization of the affected vessels also will be happening. That will be the, this much will be the particular features of a thromboangiitis obliterans or Berger's disease. It is a known atherosclerotic inflammatory disease affecting small and medium sized arteries and veins of upper and lower extremities. So there will not be any particular predilection for particular parts of body. Especially it will be affecting upper and lower extremities, especially arteries and veins of upper and lower extremities, though it is a condition affecting arteries and veins. There will not be any further formation of atherosclerotic plaques like formations within the arteries and veins. It's a known atherosclerotic inflammatory disease. Even though it's an inflammatory condition, or the condition affecting arteries and veins with the presence of inflammation, there will not be any presence of atherosclerosis like a plaques like structures within the lining of arteries and veins, and particularly affecting arteries and veins of upper and lower extremities, within that small and medium sized arteries and veins. It can be affected cerebral, visceral and coronary vessels also. Apart from upper and lower extremities, arteries and veins, it can affect cerebral arteries and veins, visceral, coronary vessels also. More commonly seen in men with chronic smoking than women. The proportion will be 3:1 of age group less than or equal to 40 years. So more commonly it is seen in men, along with the predisposing factor with the risk condition of smoking, chronic smoking. And the ratio with respect to men and women, the more incidence will be in men only, as a ratio considering 3:1 of age group less than or equal to 40 years. So within a heading of peripheral arterial disease, we can split it infective and non-infective particularly. What are the diseases affecting the peripheral arterial system? Can be divided into the conditions which will be affecting us and continuation of infective and non-infective atmosphere. So within infective conditions, it will be syphilitic, non-syphilitic, tuberculous conditions. This much conditions should be assigned under infective conditions of a peripheral arterial diseases, while you consider the non-infective conditions, which will not be any particular symptoms present with respect to infective signs and symptoms, that will be aligned as collagen vascular diseases, Wegener's syndrome, Kawasaki syndrome, Berger's disease, Raynaud's disease. So the disease TA or Berger's disease will be coming under non-infective peripheral arterial disease. We'll discuss regarding the history of TAO. It was first reported by the physician Felix von Winiwarter in 1879 in Australia. In 1879, he described a situation involving 57-year-old male patient who had an unusual obliteration of the arteries and veins of the leg. So the first physician in Australia in the year of 1879, he firstly reported the case along with a 57-year-old male patient. The physician's name is physician Felix von Winiwarter. He had found out in his clinic a 57-year-old male patient's case who had an unusual obliteration of the arteries and veins of the leg. That was the finding he found out from the patient. unusual obliteration of the arteries and veins of the legs. He attributed this disorder to new growth of tissue from the intima and proposed the name endarteritis obliterans. Firstly, it was named like endarteritis obliterans, though this condition was affected with the arteries of that person. He firstly proposed the name endarteritis obliterans, especially regarding the disorder affecting or attributed to tissues of the intima of the arteries. Von Winniwarter pointed out characteristic features distinguishing this condition from atherosclerosis, specifically hypertrophy of the tunica intima, thrombosis and fibrosis of the vascular wall. Meantime, he again differentiated the characteristic features, how we can differentiate this condition, the TIO, from the condition of atherosclerosis. So how we can differentiate the endarteritis obliterans and the particular clinical condition he found out from that patient and the clinical condition of atherosclerosis, particularly with the endarteritis obliterans conditions, hypertrophy of tunica intima was present along with the presence of thrombosis and fibrosis of the vascular wall. So with respect to these three clinical features, he could differentiate the condition from atherosclerosis. He pointed out this disease resulted from excessive overgrowth of the tunica intima, and he therefore referred to it as endarteritis obliterans. Therefore, he further pointed out that the disease was because of excessive overgrowth of the tunica intima layer of the arteries, and therefore he referred to it as endarteritis obliterans. So finally, he was pointed out one more clinical feature: excessive overgrowth of the layer of the arteries, nothing but tunica intima. Thereby, he confirmed with the terminology endarteritis obliterans. Winniwarter's discovery was not the first modern description of the condition, as 3 years earlier, bacteriologist Carl Friedlander referred to it as arteritis obliterans. So, years before the invention of von Winniwarter, one more scientist called Carl Friedlander, who was termed the same condition, named arteritis obliterans. In 1918, American surgeon Leo Berger further described the disease, and in 1924 published a monograph based on analysis taken from 500 patients. One more physician named Leo Berger in the year of 1924 again published a monograph regarding the clinical aspects of the same disease, while extracted the case details from 500 patients. The disease was later referred to as Winniwarter-Berger syndrome, Berger's disease, or as thromboangitis obliterans. So soon after the findings from American surgeon Leo Berger, later the disease renamed as Winniwarter-Berger syndrome or Berger's disease or thromboangitis obliterans. Epidemiology. Although Berger's disease occurs throughout the world, it is more prevalent in the Middle East and Asia compared to North America and Western Europe. Berger's disease occurs almost exclusively in the men younger than 45 years of age. Historical data demonstrating only 1-2% of patients who were women. More recent series revealed that women make up to 80-23% of Berger's disease patients. So throughout, if you consider the condition throughout the world, it can be happen at any area of the world. It was more prevalent in the Middle East and Asia portions compared with the North America and Western Europe. And almost the prevalence is more happening in the men younger than age group of 45 years. And consider the historical data, 1-2% of the patients who were women, considering the previous records. And recent studies also revealed that 80-23% of the Berger's disease happening with the women category also. Incidence and prevalence. Incidence of thromboangitis obliterans is 80-12 per 1 lakh adults in the United States, approximately 0.75% of all patients with peripheral vascular disease. 1947, the prevalence of the disease in the United States was 10 cases per 1 lakh population. Considering that kind of population, 1 lakh, as per comparing with 1 lakh population, it was 104 at 1947. Since then, the prevalence has fallen to an estimated 12 to 20 cases per 1 lakh population. PAO is more common in males. Male to female ratio, it is 3:1. However, the incidence in women is believed to be increasing, probably as a consequence of the growing frequency of smoking among women. So, it was seriously found that the tendency of smoking among women was increasing in its high peak. So, chances of occurrence of PAO in women also has been found out at that time as a probable consequence. Disease is relatively less common in of Northern Europe descent and natives of India, Korea and Japan have the highest incidence of PAO. And particularly the actual prevalence of PAO has not been established precisely due to three reasons. There was some kind of obstructions to found out or to analyze with the actual prevalence rate of PAO, and those reasons were geographical difference in the prevalence of this condition. With regards to the geographical difference or geographical distribution, it was difficult to confirm or analyze with the actual prevalence rate of PAO. And the second reason was lack of non-invasive diagnostic methods enabling differentiation between TAO and obliterative atherosclerosis in individuals with a mild degree of ischemia. So that was a keynote point with regarding to difficulty in diagnosing or difficult to predict with the prevalence rate. There was particular kind of lack of non-invasive diagnostic methods. Adequate methods or adequate type of non-invasive diagnostic methods were not available at that time, and that kind of non-invasive diagnostic methods was indeed to differentiate between the particular clinical conditions like TAO and obliterative atherosclerosis in individuals with a mild degree of ischemia. So most of the cases it was just like troubling, like what was the actual case and what was the actual clinical signs and symptoms, and most of the cases it was very much difficult to differentiate between TAO and obliterative atherosclerosis condition with mild degree of ischemia. So that kind of particular kind of lacuna was present at that time. Because of these two reasons, actual prevalence rate of TAO could not be established correctly. Etiology. The association between heavy tobacco use and the development of Purvis disease is extremely strong and also been associated to exposure to other substances other than tobacco, including cocaine and cannabis. So considering the etiological factors, the foremost role was always placed by extreme use of the tobacco only, especially via smoking. So the high degree of smoking and high degree of tobacco was consecutively preceded with the etiological factor. And apart from the heavy use of tobacco, the other substances like cocaine and cannabis has also placed the main role in order to propagate with the disease. So most of the conditions, heavy rate of smoking was the foremost etiological factor. A potential mechanism that has been proposed involves endothelial cell injury induced by one or more of the components in tobacco, with the subsequent development of autoantibodies directed against endothelial cells. So what was the defect or what was the antagonistic procedure happening whenever using with a heavy tobacco? There will be propagation of a particular mechanism will be causing destruction of the endothelial cell lining, or the particular injury will be happening to the endothelial cells induced by excessive tobacco use, and the components which are present within the tobacco will be responsible for the endothelial cell injury, and subsequently from that condition it will go for development of autoantibodies that will be directed against endothelial cells. So at the same time endothelial cell injury will be happening. Meantime, development of autoantibodies will be developing along with endothelial cell injury. In addition, histopathological studies done in vessels with the thromboangitis obliterans show increased deposition of autoantibodies, deposition of immune complex and collagen sensitized lymphocytes. How this statement was proved not. Like histopathological, particular histopathological studies were done with respect to the vessels, and it was the samples were collected from the patients along with those people who were affecting with the thrombophlebitis obliterans. The vessels, especially the histopathological studies of the vessels with the cases of thrombophlebitis obliterans, should be selected for the histopathological study, and they were found out that increased deposition of the autoantibodies within throughout the vessels of the arteries and veins. Deposition of immune complex and collagen sensitive T lymphocytes also were found out throughout the vessels. So histopathological studies proved out that presence of the autoantibodies and other immune complex components, and along with the collagen sensitized T lymphocytes. Thereby, they have proven out that smoking has an increased tendency or increased affinity towards more propagation of the disease. Pathologically, the thrombus in TAO is highly cellular with much less intense cellular activity in the wall of the blood vessel and a preserved internal elastic lamina. Pathologically, if you consider within the TAO, within the condition of thrombophlebitis obliterans, the thrombus which will be present within the vessels, it will be highly cellular in nature, and they have very less intense characteristic feature of cellular activity wherever they are situating within the wall of the blood vessel. They have very less enable state, they will be along with very less intense cellular activity, and they will be highly cellular in nature also, and a preserved internal elastic lamina. In addition to, TAO differs from many other types of vasculitis in that the usual immunological markers, elevation of acute phase reactants such as erythrocyte sedimentation rate and C-reactive protein, rheumatoid factor, are usually normal or negative. Most of the conditions, though it's a non-inflammatory condition, it's a non-atherosclerotic condition, it can be found out regarding some kind of markers regarding elevation of acute phase reactants or ESR level, C-reactive protein, rheumatoid factor levels will be some kind of perception, it will be normal in nature, or in some nature it will be negative. Though it can be differed from many other types of vasculitis conditions or peripheral arterial diseases, along with the presence of some usual immunological markers, we can differentiate it regarding the level of that immunological markers. In terms of its histopathological findings, Burgess disease differs from other vasculitis in that the vessel wall is relatively spared of the inflammatory processes. What will be the particularly happening in the condition of Burgess diseases? When you go through the histopathological findings, the vascular, especially the vessel wall, arterial veins, it will be relatively spared of the inflammatory process. And the Burgess disease differs from other vasculitis conditions. In case of TAO, the vascular vessels or vessel will be relatively spared off from the inflammatory processes. So from other, apart from the other vasculitis conditions, you can differentiate the TAO with reference to characteristic features happening to the vascular walls along with the sparing the action of the inflammatory processes. In the acute phase of the disease, affected vessels, especially arteries and veins, it will be happening wherever it is affecting, and it will go on with the acute phase of the TAO, are occluded with a highly inflammatory thrombus that is usually infiltrated by polymorphonuclear leukocytes and multinucleated giant cells that form microabscesses. So foremost, microabscesses will be forming in case of acute phases of the TAO. So in acute phases, anyhow, affected vessels should be there, arteries and veins. Further, occlusion will be happening with respect to the normal structure of the affected vessels, especially arteries and veins. And there should be high inflammatory thrombus formation will be there, and that thrombus will be usually infiltrated, will be gone through with, along with the condition of polymorphonuclear leukocytes. Along with the inflammatory thrombus, polymorphonuclear leukocytes will be present there, and multinucleated giant cells that form microabscesses. So this much clinical features will be present within the acute phase of the disease. Considering the etiological factors, till now we were discussing a general introduction regarding etiology, and point wise regarding the general etiological factors, role of smoking, genetic causes, hypercoagulability condition, endothelial dysfunction, role of infection, immunological mechanisms, this much factors will be play a play an important role in condition of further progression of the disease. So in detail we will discuss these points in the next part. Thank you.